everyone. Welcome to Cisco Support Community Meetup today. A couple of logistics things. I see a lot of people standing today. We have a good turnout, more than we expected. So two things. One is a seat. There is more seats in that storage room. If you want to bring yourself, you can go inside and take a seat from there. And sitting on the hallway or, you know, like side, probably easier than standing. And the second thing is that the back, when you go out and turn to your right side, that's right there. We actually, you know, ran out of food. Sorry for that. We're going to prepare more next time. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Okay, my name is Qiming Huang, and I'm a product manager for Cisco Support Community. This meetup is organized by Cisco Support Community, which is part of Cisco Services. It's my pleasure and honor today to have a very strong panel with us. They're going to discuss Internet of Everything, big data, and innovation. And after the panel, we also have Cisco EIR program, Entrepreneur in Residence. It's more like an incubation program. Director coming, his name is Tom Yoritaka, and he will briefly talk about Cisco EIR program and introduce a couple of startups which is incubated in that program. First of all, I would first thank Silicon Valley Bank for sponsoring the venue and food. Now, please allow me to introduce Winston Chow, relationship advisor at Silicon Valley Bank. Winston, thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Winston from Silicon Valley Bank, and welcome to SVB. Silicon Valley Bank has been around for 30 years. It's been around for 30 years. We work with the technology companies of all sizes. We also work with the venture capital private equity firms at a global scale. So we provide banking and financial services. The group that I'm from is a global team, more focused on technology companies and VC firms based in Asia. Again, welcome to SVB. Enjoy your conference.
Thanks, Vincent. Also, I want to thank ReedSmith Law Firm as our another food sponsor today. And Tom, our partner from ReedSmith, he will speak at a panel later when the panel started. Next, I would like to invite Rob Law. He's from the Meetup of Idea to IDO, and he promotes our event this time as an event promoter.
He's an Idea IPO member. All right. So who came to hear some really good content today? All right. Who came for the free lunch? Well, I know my members very well. So we've been doing a lot of events here in the Valley for a while. Our mission is to promote entrepreneurship, support entrepreneurs, build community, and provide value. So hopefully I can get some value today. I just want to highlight a few events we have on our calendar. We have a tryout for pitching before investors next night. We have a series of pitch events to investors next Wednesday, 23rd. And we have lots of other events in the calendar, including the evaluation workshop next Tuesday with Brooklyn Lewis. So we partner with a lot of organizations, VC firms, investor, angel groups, law firms, colleges, and universities. So today we're privileged to partner with Silicon Valley Bank and Cisco. So I hope everybody enjoys the event, and thanks for coming.
Thanks, Rob. Thank you for being our promotion partner. And last but not least, I would like to thank our team, Crystal Perez. She's our partner program manager. She manages Cisco Support Community Partner Program. If you want to work together with us, like this kind of event or having your ads on our community, you can talk with her. She will be around for a while. And the second the team member I'll introduce is Dan Narek, and she's a program manager. We continue to organize a lot of online webinars and ask expert forum discussion. And she's a major lead to manage those programs. If you want to be Cisco product expert, you want to contribute the content, contribute your knowledge and your your experience, then you can talk with her. She will be around too. So without further ado, I would like to schedule the most exciting part of today's meetup. Let's welcome our panel today. So I will just hand over the stage to Keith, and please you can just take it over. Thank you.
Thank you. And great job in getting this fantastic crowd together. Thank you. So we talked before, we're going to try to be very efficient and not do kind of 20-minute introductions of ourselves. So what we're going to do is start off by talking about what the Internet of Things is as part of introducing ourselves. So we're going to introduce ourselves and give a little bit of content at the same time that kicks the thing off. And we're going to go reverse order from this side. Just briefly on me, I am obviously British, if you can't detect the accent. I moved to the Valley in 96 and I run a thing called Archimedes Labs. Archimedes Labs invests in very early stage companies. Archimedes 1 was known for Techcrunch, which was acquired by AOL. Archimedes 2, which I run now, has 13 companies. We just launched one last year called Downtown, that is a lending shop from home in downtown Palo Alto, and has stuff delivered to you or go pick it up in the store. It's using iBeacons in the stores to know where you're going as well. And we're just beginning to raise Archimedes 3, and the front page for the potential piece says things, the cloud, and smartphones, and talks about what the three of those things together will change. Having said that, I know almost nothing compared to these guys, so I'm going to be mainly listening and prompting today. So let's start on my left there. I think you're going to stand up and use the left hand because one of you is smart.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
Okay,
what the heck. I'm Tom Quinlan. I'm a partner at ReedSmith, large international law firm. And just wanted to show you a few slides. We're a top 20 global firm. We're in all the usual places. 100 plus lawyers in China, large group of lawyers in the EU, large in the Middle East. And we have top 10 law firm here in the U.S. A lot of the key commerce centers are covered there. We have about 1,200 lawyers in the U.S., 400 lawyers over in the EU. We have 130 lawyers in Asia. And, you know, apart from being large, we're good. We get recognized often for client service. We do a lot of interesting work. I've thrown a few in here that I thought might be relevant to the group. We do a lot of venture capital work in Europe, New York, Pittsburgh, Chicago, and California, as well as in Asia. We do pretty much all different kinds of representation. We act for some VCs with their portfolio companies. Primarily, though, we do company representation. And we take them from bench to IPO and beyond. I actually have been one of the leaders in the capital markets practice worldwide. We do a lot of data privacy work. The three areas or industries that we've focused on are energy, life science, and financial institutions. And as you can tell, those are all very regulatory, regulation sensitive, especially when it comes to data security and privacy. We've defended countless class actions for data breaches, data theft, and have some of the most experienced lawyers in the country working with us. Of course, we do IP all over the place, from trade secret information all the way through to patent prosecution and protection. And we do a lot of litigation in this space as well. As you can imagine, we do a lot of M&A, both domestic and cross-border. The reason I mention this is ReedSmith is a household name in my household, but it's not really a household name out here in California. We have an office in Page Mill with some very talented people, office in San Francisco, a couple of offices in Southern California as well. And afterwards, if you have specific questions, please feel free to ask them. A lot of self-serving accolades and awards here, but I just wanted to introduce you to the firm. My own practice is fairly wide in a number of areas. I started out as a corporate and transactional lawyer, so I do a lot of private company formation, governance, advice, financing. But I also am a certified information privacy professional, so I do a lot of data security work. Intellectual property is a love of mine, and so I wind up doing a lot of IT agreements, you know, either outsourcing agreements or BPaaS, SaaS agreements on either side. Do a lot of work for financial institutions and IT companies here in California. That's who I am in a nutshell. My approach to the Internet of Things is, as you can tell, a privacy perspective. For most of our clients, we're coming in at the end, helping them get through some kind of a trauma. But for a lot of our early stage companies, we're trying to make sure that as they innovate, they do it in a conscious way and have good advice. We'll talk a little bit about that later.
That's all. Next up, Tony.
Can you guys hear me, or do I hear Mike?
You can hear Mike.
Okay, perfect. I like Tom's tagline, we're big and we're good. Awesome. So, pleasure being here. My name is Tony Shakib. I'm the Vice President for Internet of Things Vertical Solutions. You know, IoT is a very big, broad area. It's very exciting. There's just so many things happening. And it's one of the major bets that Cisco is making in this space. So, given that it's so big and it's so broad, the challenge is if you don't define solutions in a way that the customers can understand it for every industry, it becomes very difficult to comprehend and to adopt. So what my group does, we are focused on initially 12 verticals that we feel is really important, and we create end-to-end solutions of which many times it consists of parts or elements from partners like SAP, you know, either at a very low level, at a like a sensor level, or at a connectivity level, and I can get into the architectures later, or all the way up to the application level, virtualization, data, and cloud. So it's a very comprehensive end-to-end solution in a way that a big customer, you know, when we go sit down and talk to the CEO of Shell, they understand how we could transform their business and how we could create new business outcomes that is important to them. It's not about networking. It's not about switches. It's like, how do I get more oil out of the ground? How do I make sure that less people die in our facilities? You know, just things that fundamental. So we create those solutions. The verticals that we cover, you know, is manufacturing. Manufacturing has two very big broad areas. It's discrete. And within discrete, there's many different sub-segments. You know, if you take the semis, auto builders, machine builders, and so on. And then there's process manufacturing, which is very data intensive. Tons of, you know, big data analytics that comes up, like oil and gas, mining, and so on. We focus on areas like utilities, you know, smart grid, distribution automation that has been around for a long time. But it's really, you know, very antiquated type of technologies that where they're operating in. We look at areas such as transportation. You know, some of you guys may have heard about positive train control. Fortunately, with all the collisions that's happening, people dying, there's a government mandate to put better signaling systems, much more modern. And there's really no air traffic control for trains. So how do we bring that kind of the technology forward? And then aviation and other parts of transportation. So that's the third one. Fourth one, you know, is where we get into much more detail into oil and gas mining. And then you go into defense, pretty big in the defense, especially as the spending is going down. They want to embrace technology. You know, you've seen some of the drones. That's just the tip of the iceberg, the kind of things that you could do with sensors around the world. And then from there, you can go into healthcare and how you really transform, you know, you provide remote healthcare, you know, as you go into some of the big societies like Japan, the aging population. There's just not enough doctors. You can't, have built enough hospitals. And even in emerging places like India and so on, there's just such a young generation that just can't build enough infrastructure. 90% of the people that go to a hospital, they don't really need to go to a hospital. So how do you deliver the same level of care, you know, remotely? So healthcare is a big one. Retail, we can get into education. And, you know, we're doing a lot of stuff around smart cities, smart government, and every one of these verticals, as you can see, it's very diverse, has a different set of buyers, has a different set of pain points, and we try to build solutions that would appeal to that audience.
Excellent. Thank you. And last up, Dinesh.
I think I'm going to need a mic. Tony's got a much better voice than I am. I am representing SAP. And for those of you who are aware about SAP, it was the world's largest enterprise application software. And one of the things, my approach to this discussion, hopefully we'll see some interesting questions around this, is going to be really around what are the business outcomes that can be delivered, how IoT is going to be relevant to that. For 40 years, SAP has essentially allowed companies to run better, allowed them to optimize process, workflows, to enable them to be able to attack new markets and do those kinds of things. IoT is yet another one of those technology trends and areas of interest which come along quite frequently. And why it focused heavily on business outcomes is they don't tend to change. Look at the simple rules of business. You want to make more money, increase revenues, increase costs. Those things are given. And those are the same yesterday as they were today. Technology is coming to the market which allows us to make adjustments to bring us to the next horizon, to enable us to make more money, increase costs. And so IoT, in a way, is another one of those trends on the back of cloud, mobile, advanced analytics, that become part of the toolkit for our customers to be able to deliver on those promises. IoT, we happen to believe inside of SAP, is a significant shift in the capabilities for our business customers to be able to hit those business outcomes. We believe that the time is now, and that's why, you know, we're getting quite aggressive about how we start to engage with this market. But ultimately, it's about how we end up delivering value. And this just becomes one of those technologies. Hopefully in some of the discussions we'll have later, we'll be able to illustrate with some examples in some of the industries that Tony's pointing out, which are very common with ours, about how this is actually going to transpire over the next few years. We tend to see things, we go to market in a similar way to Cisco around a number of different industries, and the pace of adoption of IoT we see is going to be different for different industries. Some of you already touched upon things like oil and gas, asset-intensive industries, which have actually been used to monitor their high-value assets for 40 years, and have been, you know, key users of embedded technologies to provide intelligence at the edge, have been around for a really long time. Those are the companies, those are the vertical markets which tend to be adopting these solutions faster. Some of the other markets will adopt them slower. You know, as SAP has to scale and expand to be able to go along with our customers at the pace that they require, and to allow them to intersect with these changes when they see fit. And these are going to be different for different industries. And hopefully that'll come out in this discussion today.
Thank you, Dinesh.
So as I was walking in, I overheard a conversation. Before I say that, just out of interest, how many people here are actually from Cisco? Plus, probably is quite a few. Not as many as I would have thought. How many are from SAP? Right. How many of you work at big companies interested in the Internet of Things? I'm supposed to say startups. How many of you are looking at doing startups? A lot of you. Okay, great. That's going to help a lot because it helps to understand who we're talking to. Let's just start here. The conversation I overheard was somebody said to the other person, we used to call it the Internet of Things, now it's the Internet of Everything. Is there a difference or is it the same thing?
Yeah, so it's... admittedly, it's a confusion that we've created, you know, at Cisco. But let me try to explain the method behind the madness. Basically, if you think about, you know, Internet of Things, it's mostly about connectivity. So what we've done at Cisco, we built a fairly large...
Excuse me, can you use a microphone, please?
Yeah, sure. My voice is not as...
Okay, can you hear me better?
Yeah, so Internet of Things is mainly around connectivity, right? So we've developed a fairly large business unit inside Cisco. You know, it's roughly about 500 engineers, and we have over 700-800 SKUs of products that are like switches, routers, access points, you know, gateways that will connect to things. And this is an area where it's changing in two dimensions and has two level of complexities. One of them is there is a lot of legacy out there built by different companies based on proprietary protocols. So if you take Honeywell, Emerson, you know, all the big industrial players that have a lot of equipment, you know, they all want to have proprietary protocols as they build the system, right, and they put the PLCs and the controllers in place. Anytime that plant grows, they go back to them, they get more sensors and so on. So how do you get all of these things to interoperate? How do you get the industry to go towards a standards-based type of thing? You know, it's challenging, but it's not going to happen overnight, right? So we're building all these gateways that can talk any kind of protocol, any kind of language, and then right at the edge, we'll convert it to IP, then we'll handle it more time. The other sort of disruption that's happening is the sensors are getting smaller, cheaper, more intelligent. I've got like $2 sensors where they can give you, you know, the five senses that a human body has, you know, almost like smell, you know, temperature and all those kind of things. They give you identity, they can extract data, they can give you the location. So just think about it. As these things are getting a lot more intelligent, how do you connect them together and how do you connect them at scale? It's a very difficult challenge. And some of these networks that we're looking at, I would argue they're going to be at least 100 times larger than an AT&T and a Verizon network. And the kind of monetization that you get out of it, like the SIM card activation, it's not like a cell phone where you have an ARPU of $100 per subscriber. You're getting $2. So you got to come up with ways that you could, you know, auto-configure 6 million smart meters with the push of a button, not like one by one and, you know. So IoT is all about that first layer of connecting the unconnected. And, you know, for us at Cisco, the reason we're so excited, this is like internet all over again at a much larger scale. You think about internet 20 years ago, where Cisco really helped build a lot of the backbone. It was all about e-commerce, and that's what made it really interesting, right? So you could connect the buyers and, you know, that, and that's really just at the level that it's stayed at in the last 20 years. It hasn't progressed beyond that. What we're trying to do at Cisco is to bring the same level of experience and disruption to all the major industries, like healthcare, like governments, and, you know, to be able to connect things and make them much more connected and create new experiences, right? So layer one is connectivity. But connectivity alone is just you connect something. So what? So what we, when we start talking about Internet of Everything, then we add three different dimensions to it. One dimension is big data analytics, because when you connect things, you get data. And right now we've generated more data in the last year than all the 6 million years before that. And that data growth is growing exponentially. And I can tell you, right now the data is coming at such a rapid rate. Like we work with Chevron, they have this term called data exhaust. And some of these oil rigs, they're getting 1 terabyte of data per day. And it's over an anemic satellite connection of 64 kilobits. There's so much data that they're throwing the good and bad away. So now, it's the age where we have to turn data to wisdom, to apply the filter and to pick up the things that are really valuable that and are actionable that you could do things with. So one dimension is big data analytics. It's going to be huge. The other dimension that we add to the IoE is business processes. So now you get all this data. So how do I make money out of it? How do we create the business outcomes that, you know, we were just discussing? So the whole business process monetization, and we have done a study at Cisco that we call the value at stake. So in this, we picked 67 use cases across two domains, public sector and private sector. And we said, if we were able to bring innovation in five areas, which was better asset utilization, improved, you know, employee productivity, and a bunch of other things, all the way down to innovation, how much business could they create? If we went and took like a company like Shell and completely modernized it,
how much more efficiently could they run? How much more business could that generate for them? So the value of stake, by the way, it came to $14.5 trillion for the private sector and about $4.5 trillion for public sector, just across these 67 use cases, right? So anyway, it's the business outcomes and what do you do with that? And then the fourth dimension is us, as people. Now, I will tell you that as things get smarter, ultimately the control will be taken away from human beings and will be done more amongst machines. But we're still relevant, you know, we're still in there. We still have to put the policy and the decision process and things like that. But then we have this notion of machine to machine, machine to people, and people to machine, and all those interactions, and how does that all come together? So once you start putting all of these together to create business outcomes, is that what we call Internet of Everything?
Does SAP use the same two terms differently or interchangeably?
We use different terminology, but I think that's just purely a question of semantics. Well, it's whatever the market's going to accept over time as well. But I have to agree with what Tony is saying. It's like, it really is the connection, interconnected, bi-directional communication between people, process, data, and machine. Thing. A plant can have a sensor, a table can have a sensor, an actuator in a plant can have a sensor. So that's how we view it. And to kind of expand upon some of the things that Tony's talking about, is it really is an outgrowth of the 20 years of what the internet's done. The internet content pushing data towards you in the 90s versus social networking, the peer-to-peer connections. All of these were precursors to enable devices to independently connect bidirectionally. So people be with machines, as I'm pointing out. What that now does, with the cost structures that are made available, is enable companies to do things that they otherwise couldn't do. Having said that, a lot of people have had ideas about what they could do with this level of interconnectedness for many years, but they just haven't been able to act upon them because it's just really cost effective. The underlying infrastructures, Cisco, lots of things that we want to use, now allow us to do those types of things. And essentially, it's this interconnected network that is going to be a challenge, really, to some of the business folks who are out there. And if I talk to some people who want to build startups and, you know, innovate in this space, it's about finding the nugget that will start to get somebody to write you a check. There's a lot of talk around it kind of things, and Tony and I were on a panel last week, and you know, I thought about what happened at CES, and essentially it's now things got hijacked by wearables. It's not that. Internet of Things, wearables, they're not strategies, they're technologies that you can use to implement your goals. What's happening today in 2014 is the level of interconnectedness is at a point where people can start to rethink some of those processes, create completely new mechanisms and new business models that you otherwise would never be able to dream of. That's the opportunity to innovate and to provide, you know, serious, dislocating value to the market.
So that's an interesting, you use the word nugget, this kind of reminds me of the nugget. This is a Estimote, a Polish company out of Krakow, I think, Beacon. And about a year ago, a little less than a year ago, Apple kind of surprised the world with the announcement of a software stack called iBeacon that relates to an underlying hardware standard called Bluetooth Low Energy. I'm going to guess that this room would not have been this full, you know, before that announcement, that something in what Apple made people aware of has galvanized the startup community to say, wow, this could be something big. And these things are kind of interesting because they don't have an IP stack in them. They're just broadcasting. They're not able to listen. They can just speak. I just wonder what your take is on what and I think it's wrong to call it iBeacon because that's just Apple's brand. Qualcomm has a competing one, and PayPal has announced one as well, and there's probably going to be lots of others. But this Bluetooth Low Energy beacons that are kind of attached, usually in a store under a table somewhere, and have the ability, you know, to be distinguished one from the other to about 4 inches. That means that they can detect your movement, but you can use them as markers for your movement in very short distances.
Does this change the world compared to, say, the sensor networks that were part of energy companies or monitoring or smart grid meter things and such?
So if you think about it, like many of the problems we're trying to solve here, it was like the same cycle in the IT. Think about how many protocols we have, FDDM, Token Ring, you know, all that kind of stuff. Over time, they converge over Ethernet and Wi-Fi, right? And then, of course, we got the licensed spectrum as well. So in the sensor networks, I get bombarded with companies. I mean, right now, there's probably 40 active companies that we're talking to. At the end of the day, you know, if I were to draw a chart, you have a set of, you know, high-value assets, like what Dinesh was saying, and low-value assets. The high-value assets, they need to be smart. In fact, we just announced a technology called fog computing, which is the inverse of cloud, that has distributed architecture, and if you're interested, I can get into it. But then there's a high-value asset, and then there's low-value assets, right? And like some places, they go and like they, from a plane, they drop like 5,000 sensors, and they do an explosion, and they do 4D seismic imaging, right? So you can't afford to even have something out of bulk, right? And then the other dimension is mobility. You have a bunch of assets that are almost like fixed, right? Like you glue it on, or you got things that are moving at moderate speeds, like up to 100 kilometers, and you got assets that are going at 300 kilometers, some of these high-speed trains and stuff like that. I mean, just to keep up with the mobility aspect of it and the handoffs and things is pretty challenging. So there's going to be many, many different technologies and some that need to operate 10 years on a battery, some of them where battery is not efficient, some that need to go like 200 kilometers on a signaling for a train system because it's in the middle of nowhere, they don't have towers, some of them they're happy if they're 2 inches apart, like RFIDs and things like that. So there's going to be a lot of innovation. We're trying to group it to 4 or 5 areas because we're being asked at Cisco to put our weight behind some of them. Because honestly, we don't want to get into the sensors piece. We're just going to have the gateways to collect it. But a lot of our big customers are coming and saying, I can't make sense of these men. Help us group it, pick a few. And we don't want to be kingmakers. We could, but so there's going to be many technologies and innovation is going to come, but at some point, you're defying the laws of physics, right? And there's some companies that are very successful, I mean, there's a few I really like, very innovative, and so on. And now some of these things are going to have, as I said, the gateway running at it. I mean, right now, we have IPv6 to a device, and then we have LISP, that this locates the location of that device from the IP address. And we can have multiple IP addresses based on every application. And the mobile based and the, you know, connectivity may not be there all the time, so you want to capture some stuff, send it up, or trickle, you know, charge it, or send it up when there is things. So it's going to be a pretty fragmented space, but over time, I think you're going to see a number of logical groupings that they will come together. Everyone, you know, once they have their gateway, you know, their agent there because it's a control point. Right, so Android obviously wants to go after it, Oracle wants to go Java, Intel wants to go Wind River. We have our own that we're trying to do at a level that's based on the networking. And then there's going to be a lot of intelligence play because typically when you know, there's going to be a lot of legacy. So everything we're talking about is say like it's from this time going forward. So what do you do with millions and millions of stuff that's already out there that people want to pay for and do things with? So there's a lot of companies that, you know, some are IP-based, some are not IP. You go pick it up, first thing people do is they put it in an SSL, which I know is a bad word these days. But as soon as you put it in a tunnel, you lose all the value and identity of what that end device was, right?
Right.
And then you're blind to it until you get to the application layer, but then it's too late. So we're trying to do it in a very intelligent way, obviously at Cisco, that you collect as much of its identity, location, color, all of its inherent stuff, so we could be much smarter the way we treat it in the network, because there's millions of these things, right? And then the information that we present to the app layer, so they could be a lot more smarter about the things, the kind of things that they could do with it. This whole sensors networks is kind of crowded. But I think it will morph into a few logical groupings and a few standards that we're going to help drive. Obviously, it's going to be a key base. And it's a fun place to watch.
So before we ask the next one, just to say, we want this to be very interactive. So if any of you at any point have questions or comments, I won't just go to you, but I'll start bringing you in and let you ask your questions. So the best way to do it is to catch my eye, and if I'm not, it means I've seen it, so I've seen you. I just wanted to ask one more question before we do that, though. Given there's a lot of people in the room looking at hospitals to do with startups, what are the big buckets of opportunity that are problems that remain to be resolved? Somebody who is only peripherally involved in the space, I, for example, feel a lot of frustration because these things are barely available yet. I mean, wait 3 months to get the rest of our, you know, test ones. I think then, so one of the frustrations I have is how real is this and what's the time frame? But what are the big problems and opportunities that people can be thinking of that Cisco would like to be solved, and SAP would like to be solved?
So I can tell you at Cisco, guys, I can see a lot of millionaires in this room. And I just gave a speech. We have this networking academy in Melbourne to 250 students, where I talked about the architecture, the foundation. I mean, essentially what at Cisco we're trying to do is to solve the connectivity issues, so you don't have to worry about it, and abstract out the networking. So you don't need to be a CCIE or a really smart networking guy to write applications. The money is going to be in the apps. You know, nobody wakes up and says, hey, I want to go buy a really good-looking router. They want to solve a business problem, right? So the money is going to be in the apps, and we're creating a platform. So we have built an architecture that has four layers. Layer one was connectivity, but I think we're there. Not quite there. I mean, it's always like some interface and stuff, but I think we got the major one. Layer two is security, because when you connect, then you're vulnerable. There's massive amounts of money to be made in security. I can't tell you. You look at New York Set 5, you look at Stuxnet, you look at what happened at Target, where people went in through the HVAC system and got connected to the point of sales, and from there stole the credit cards. So we have things like ICE at Cisco, Identity Services Engine, that we can segment by role or by where you are, what you do. Anyway, security is the next layer. So we're going to spend a lot of money, and there's a lot of room for innovation. Because the smarter that the industry get, the smarter the hackers get. You can never say we're there. It's going to be like a game. It's a video game, you know, just like, you know, cat and mouse. Next layer, we're getting into what we call auto magic or auto management. Once you start getting hundreds of millions of these devices, there's not that many people that are intelligent enough to go configure these networks, set up the right security policy. Things have to be automated. So there's going to be a very sophisticated level of automation that needs to come. There's a lot of room for innovation. And the fourth layer that we're putting all of our energy and great partners like Dinesh, SAP, and others is app enablement. Make it easy for an open development community to come and develop applications. So we want to have the iTunes of IoT and have as many people like yourselves. So like in as I said, in Melbourne, I talked about the architecture and turn it back to students. Like, if you were to start your company, what would you do? And you wouldn't believe the ideas that was coming out. It's phenomenal. And we actually want to encourage that. We have done two other things that might be of interest to you guys. We recently announced a $100 million incubation fund. So we are looking for ideas, and we will invest in companies to actually go innovate in any of these layers, but in particular at the app layer. And we've already invested in four or five. I'm on that committee. We are also setting up a number of hackathons with all the top universities, with MIT, you know, in China. The amount of innovation coming out of China or third world countries, by the way, not to say China is a third world country, but it's phenomenal. Things in Vietnam that we're seeing. So this is like opening it up to everybody. In India, there's a bunch of people that really care about their community, right? Awesome stuff that's coming out of there. That while women are going like from there to work, and they have this thing that can detect them and you know, so they're safe, and it's just, so there's going to be a lot of room for innovation, ideas, and the Internet of Things is not going to be a static thing. In fact, if you build it that way, by the time we get to it, it's outdated. So we try to make sure that we get into software, services, future-proof innovation, scale, that this thing you can constantly, just as a treadmill, you're building things on top of it, and you're driving the innovation. Very exciting area.
I want to kind of go back here and put a lot of the estimates and SAP's opinion on level technologies where I'm building. The market will tell us how this is all going to pan out. And as long as the data is being collected, you know, we believe that the opportunity, as Tony says, is to be able to innovate and create those applications which are going to allow people to consume the data. Same problem around big data, you know, collecting the data, running analytics, what are you going to do with it? Needs to be actionable insight. We believe, ultimately, inside of what the Internet of Things is able to do for you is it delivers a level of automation. It delivers a level of automation.
Great retail.
It delivers a level of automation, and that's where maybe people need to start to think. If you can think about how these devices and sensors are going to proliferate, and they go beyond the high-value assets. What can you do in a mine when you had 14 high-value $2 million assets, which were monitored pretty effectively for the last 20 years? What can you do when you've got 4,000 workers monitored? Every single machine tool monitored? Those are the kinds of opportunities which, if we provide the application enablement platforms and the ability to run these things at internet scale, that's the level of opportunity that the people in this room should really be looking at. I'm not saying we shouldn't be thinking about through the security bit. That's definitely areas where Cisco, ourselves, other companies that are involved in this ecosystem are going to be paying that type of attention. Tony said something which is a word that's near and dear to my heart, is that abstract the complexities away. That's really what we're going to try and do. And that's what innovators need to look at. As opposed to working on lower level details, they should look to see where is the industry going? What are the breakthrough opportunities I could get to if I actually tie these things together in a way that's never been done before? That is what I would kind of stress that everybody in this room looks to focus on.
So let's start bringing people in. Please introduce yourself very, very briefly, and don't talk massively long. I don't mind if you have an opinion rather than a question, that's fine. We're all grown ups, we can react to opinions, but don't go on forever.
Actually, Tony probably already answered part of the question, so I'm going to change the question a little bit. So about the enabling technology, I haven't been in touch with like what Cisco is doing in terms of doing it, but I want to know the approach. Is it going to be more of an enterprise software offering that, you know, people pay and then they try, or you're going to go open source strategy that you would actually involve developers, involve the community as you actually develop that technology?
Tom wants to go.
Well, yeah, I want to actually add to your question. Tom has answered to a wide variety of names.
Can you repeat the question, please?
So the question is, what is Cisco's approach to the enterprises? Is there going to be a contribution of software that's kind of open source that developers can interact with, or is it going to be paid for offerings that are proprietary? I guess is the implication of the question.
Yeah, and what I would add is how well, it's wonderful for an early stage company to work with a gold standard provider, Cisco and SAP. I'm sure the expenses have dropped quite a bit, and so along with that, and the question about working with developers, you know, how good a partner is Cisco and SAP with an early stage company?
No, it's a fair question. Let me answer you this way, right? So first of all, we launched a new architecture back in February of this year at DistribuTech. That we call the fog computing, and the analysts were kind of reacting to it, and then we call it IOX. So what we're trying to do is actually quite interesting. Most of our edge devices, right, the gateways, run an Intel dual-core processor, And every time we wanted to run a business application, right, it took like a year to integrate with iOS and all that kind of stuff. So now we, with iOS, we came up with a new architecture where we put a hypervisor on our, all of our edge devices that our networking, you know, all the great stuff you get from iOS runs on one core. And we set, open up a second host core processor for any kind of applications. So we call it BYOA, bring your own application or bring your own interface. Because there's so many sensors that we talked about. And now we're opening it up to the world, saying anybody, you've got a new business application, run it on the network. And in most places, when you go into the industrial world, they have like a switch that does the networking next to a robot. And this robot has a PLC, a programmable logic controller, which is nothing more than a PC running Windows from 10 years ago. So now we're trying to get rid of that second processor and suck it into the gateway on the network. So not only do you do the networking, you can do this. So along with that, we're opening up a new program called DevNet. That's all based on Agile, and it's all based on an open development community. And there's a program called CDN, which is very easy. We have hundreds of thousands of people, but it's mostly on the enterprise side. And now we're making it very friendly for what we call the OT, the outside time technologies. So anybody in all these hackathons, it's universities. You know, so kids with a laptop, they can come and compile code, submit it through the CDN, and then we have a program that from the cloud, they can take that application, download it to all these millions of gateways, start the program, stop it, query it, get the data, all that kind of stuff. Make it really easy to do it. Now, down to the monetization, like, are we at the level of maturity that we really know how we're going to, like, the iTunes? Not quite there yet. Everything's kind of recent. We're experimenting with it, trying to get there. But we really are trying to get out of our own way. So create the platform, make it easy to write applications, you know, start by really established customers, partners that have like visualization, you know, predictive analytics. I mean, some of these companies are very sophisticated that we're dealing with. So like SAP or the likes of SAP can do that. We have a professional services organization within Cisco that have 200 people in India that could do some of these things. And then really our goal, big strategy is to open it up, make it very friendly and simple for people to come, write applications and scale.
I just want to kind of add to Tom's question about what SAP does in this case. So obviously it's an applications provider, you know, we build packaged applications and so on. Over the last few years, we've become more specifically a technology provider by building different technology components. And the way that you do that, and you start to get market acceptance of that, is you start to create platforms. So Michel Sik, our CTO and executive board member, has gone on record as saying SAP is now a platform company. What we've realized, and this is without anything to do with IoT, is that the pace of business is changing so fast that we can't be there to solve everybody's problem. Not with on-premise software, obviously. We don't even believe SaaS, cloud deployments, are the way to solve it. You have to devolve last-mile innovation and capabilities to the people to solve a problem at a place and a time that they're choosing, at their political priority. And so moving to the platform model is important. One of the core components in terms of the renewal of SAP is our in-memory database, HANA. And that major attribute, as far as HANA is concerned, is real-time. We think real-time is fundamental in anything to do with IoT. So making that available is part of our startup focus program. 1,200 companies already developing on HANA, a lot of them in the IoT space, in terms of using sensor technologies. That's how we choose to attack the market in terms of the fast-paced innovation. There is tremendous amounts of innovation going on in the larger companies as well. And the platform model works fabulously well for them as well. In the fact that we can provide them, again, this abstraction of complexity is a critical term. Is that they don't have to worry about the database level, except from the application level. We work with partners such as Cisco so that the people essentially see an end-to-end solution. When I said we were somewhat invisible to the lower ends of the stack, that's true. There is no reason for SAP to feel like it should be involved in device connectivity platforms. We don't do that. We do a lot of other things really well, And what we want to do is send the signal to the marketplace that working with companies such as Cisco, we're doing best of breed technologies. You know, we allow them to innovate, create the kinds of things that they're known for. We deliver application and application enablement platforms. We give you access to absolute cutting edge technologies such as HANA, our complex event processing technologies. And more importantly for this audience, we give you access to create logical integration with process and workflows that run businesses. So if any of you out there are not considering selling to enterprises, at the end of the day, SAP is very, very fortunate to be the company that runs most major companies' enterprises. SCM, SRM, financials, HM, human capital management, all of these things run an SAP system. And what we find is the true value and promise of IoT is not the fact that it sets up a flag or sends you an SMS that this device is going to fail. Is that that connects directly into a service management module. It fires off all the right processes that you already have in place to make it effective. Those are the things I think we bring to the market that you can then accommodate and use to be able to deliver solutions that will be successful.
Okay, I've got someone in the middle there.
Dave, just a serial entrepreneur. Tony, very intrigued by the phrase, you already sort of touched on this in the comment for us. iTunes for the Internet of Things. Just a concept at this point is what I'm getting.
So the question is, what's really meant by the concept of iTunes for the Internet of Things? And iTunes is two things. It's a big centralized database of music and movies. And then secondly, it's a cross-platform client consumer.
So 2 weeks ago at Vegas, at our partner summit, I really want to, after this, we stop talking about Cisco and talk about you guys, right? We did announce this concept that we call InterCloud, right? Some people thought we're going to go head-to-head and compete with AWS. Yes, we are. But it's much more than that. It really is this platform that we can start hosting and developing applications and exploiting it over any kind of public or private cloud, or even start in a private cloud, and as things scale up and security is subsided and all that kind of stuff, it can be moved around. It's essentially a virtual unit, right, that you can move around. So that is the platform that we announced, and now we're working on all the tools. A lot of these things, I think, we have it available, all the APIs and SDKs that we're doing with friendly partners, just to make sure it's sorted through and it's clean and all that stuff. And you're going to see many more announcements, you know, coming out starting from June onwards to start unveiling that process. Right. But, you know, there are many other stuff that you then start getting into, like the data federation, data ownership, who owns the data, security, privacy laws, all that kind of stuff. So there's a lot of complexity around that. But, you know, just to turn this thing around for you guys, right, you don't have to do a lot of heavy lifting, the big stuff. There's so much opportunity. I could, just based on, I used to run the service provider business at Cisco, right? So I know all the big SPs. And how all the over-the-tops came and disrupted their business, right? So they became nothing more than plumbers, and all the high-value stuff got sucked through the analytics to the upper layers. They monetized that, right? So this is like that game all over again. And you don't want to be southbound, you want to be northbound. But right, all the service providers that we talk to, there are, I don't want to say begging, but close to it, to, for us, to help them go up the value curve. So they're not just a SIM connection at $1.50 a month, they're getting about $12 a month for having all the analytics and services and predictive maintenance and things that, you know, companies like SAP and us can do. So in the last year and a half that I've gotten into IoT, I've been fortunate enough to spend time with different verticals. So you go really deep with the oil and gas guys. And even within oil and gas, there's upstream extraction, there's midstream, there's all the pipelines, there's all the refineries, and then there's the retail business. And you start getting deep into it, and all you have to be is just be smart. It's like a
I have a bunch of guys that are like CIA profilers. You know nothing. You're walking into an industry, you ask questions. Well, how many trains do you have? How do they run? What is the control point? And they don't know any of these things because they're not that sophisticated. And you start putting the pieces together and say, wow, you know, just look at just simple automation. I can turn this industry up to upside down. And you go into healthcare, you go into utilities, and any one of these things, it doesn't have to be very big. There's so many niches that you can go look at and just turn it upside down, and it's very high margin, high value stuff. This is not something that's been crushed over and commoditized, and you know, the Chinese have already got into the game. It's like fresh territory. So I would start looking at these industries. I can start 30 startups tomorrow. Just by learning from them, look at how they operate and how you could just apply technology to innovate. And it doesn't have to be at Cisco scale or level or connectivity. You could just be connecting like 10,000 sensors to do X and get human beings out of the control. You know, we had a meeting with the Sisters of Mercy Hospital, right? And I'm saying, the hell are we talking to hospitals? So they come in and, you know, before we get into all the stuff, I asked their CIO, what is your biggest business problem? And they said, you know, our nurses' productivity is very low. Why? 50% of their time, they're looking for things. Things, like what things? Like, and then you start getting into it. Or they have 3 times the number of wheelchairs that they need to, because they can never find them. Or there's a 30 of them in one. So you put sensor on these things, you start tracking it with Wi-Fi triangulation. Simple applications like that, people would love you for it, and they will pay you a lot of money. So every industry that you go to, there's tons of these things. And that's where you guys need to be thinking. And if it's at a scale, you can put it on a Cisco CDN, bring it on. You can do it on your own, good for you. Tons of things to do.
Just throw it in there. Hands up if you're actually working on something on the internet. If you're actually working on something now. Keep your hand up if you don't mind talking about it. Not in detail, just in general. Okay. So I'm going to come back to you guys. I'm going to ask you to put your hands up again after this. So we want to hear what you guys are doing.
So I want to address very specifically the question around iTunes. I left it out when I talked about our platform enablement. What you get with SAP is that 74% of the world's GDP runs through SAP systems. There's nearly every single major corporation which should be customers that people in this room covet are our customers today. There is really no mutual customer that we don't have a relationship with. The ability to deliver a platform which allows people to innovate also said that we need other people to come in. We've got some of these technologies and capabilities, especially around IoT, with all the assets on listening. But we also enable you to sell that. And that's important. We have to have a marketplace. But we do have a mechanism. We have been thinking about the iTunes thing. Because we're further up the stack on the application side, it was always top of mind for us. And that's obviously one of the things that the startup focused companies, 1,200 or so, that are part of the program, and are coding already, they're looking at our customer base. We can bring that to the marketplace. And, you know, there's new large customers. Large companies develop every few years, but those all tend to be customers. And so it's not just the case that we bring deep level technology and capabilities and partnerships with companies such as Cisco to the marketplace, we also give you a conduit to sell those products. And if you look at the HANA marketplace, you will see that it's a low friction ability to be able to consume products, and not just SAP products, but our partners. That can be built on our systems, share common platforms, and get to market with that level of integration. So our customers, the biggest corporation, have an understanding of what the qualification, the capability, and the logical integration can get with that product. I just wanted to add.
Right. So okay, let's go back to the group.
Hi, I'm Sam. I do social media blogging and video marketing. And my question is,
tell you what we'll do, just find out.
I have the microphone, Keith.
Oh, you do. Mm-hmm. Maybe give them the. Then I want to repeat the question.
Thank you.
Say the numbers.
Hi, I'm Sam. I do social media blogging and video marketing. My question is, since everybody's crazy about new apps and all that new ideas, where do you think we're going to be in the next 10 to 15 years? Because a lot of these people, they're going to be doing the same ideas. Few of them, I know that a lot of people come in with great ideas. What do you think is going to be in about 10 to 15 years?
I'm not going to let them answer that question, because if they try to tell you what's going to happen the next time,
what do you guys think?
The meeting will end. Let's say the next 12 months. Hold that thought, make a note, and then so back your hands up if you're working in this space. And let's pick you first. Tell us what you're doing, and if you have questions, that's fine as well as part of it.
My name is Lauren McIntosh. I'm the CEO of a company called Empower You. We're all aware there's an increasing number of elders in our population, and they want to stay in their own homes for as long as possible. But that makes their families nervous when there's an elder at home alone. So we're placing sensors in Grandma's house using sparse signal analytics to place as few sensors as possible so she's not feeling spied on. And we are creating Grandma's activity pattern so that we can tell the family on their mobile devices every day, at any time the family wants to look, if Grandma's up and around and on her normal activity schedule. And then we're using the predictive analytics to determine what the expected activities are, such that if those expected activities are missing, and Grandpa did not turn on his television at 8 o'clock this morning to watch the news as he usually does, that we will let the family know then that they should probably check on Grandpa. And we're doing this because it costs thousands of dollars a month for an elder to live in assisted living, of which there's not enough places anyway. So by using a $40 to $50 a month subscription lease model to place these sensors into the analytics, we can keep Grandma in her own home as long as possible. And the sensors that we're using are commodity sensors, as you just talked about, from security, home energy management, health and fitness, and safety applications. And we just get these systems that have open APIs, place them, and do the work ourselves on top. Thank you.
Spying for good.
So that is wonderful. That's it's a great cause, and I love those things. But one thing that I just wanted to extract out from what you're doing, and maybe back to your question, I think, you know, the future is going to go more into analytics and into what we call at Cisco, we have a program called learning machines, right? That machines are going to learn themselves, because you just can't have people that can go and program these things. You know, there's another fantastic company in Boston that we're working with that essentially allows you to take a video and you put it in a place and you put it in a learning mode for like 2 weeks. And this thing just observes the behavior of what things should happen. And then you let it set alerts after that when something's out of the ordinary, right? So when they did one on a train track, and you know, when the dogs are going versus humans and all that stuff, figured it out. And then, you know, the first trigger that it had is when an elderly gentleman started driving his truck down the tracks. And I bet you any programmer would have never thought of even thinking of that as someone that a human would do, to program the video to look for it. But these kind of self-learning machines and stuff like that, those kind of higher level of intelligence, it's going to be really cool and it's going to be very important. So I love what you're doing, and any kind of like further automation that these things can learn from Grandpa automatically, that's cool.
Yeah. I need to talk to you later. I may have some customers for you.
Came specifically to talk to you, so we're good.
Terrific. And I'm not asking you a question. I just want to use this opportunity, if I could, to take a minute or two to talk about data privacy. Now, this cuts right to the kernel of a wide variety of concerns. And you've seen that there are a number of industries where this particular, where information is very sensitive. And it's already been occupied by legislation and whatnot. It's, you know, certainly financial institutions, it's healthcare, and utility information, and some other areas as well. Just to make a pitch, as you're starting your company, as you're working on your product, please do keep data privacy in mind. And data is not only an IP asset, so that you want to protect it from people outside stealing it, but it's also somebody else's property, or at least in the current legal regime, something that other people have claims to or interests in. And there are a number of people in the legal world who are thinking of their own products
and services. There's a very entrepreneurial plane as far. There's people in government who are charged with taking care of privacy, and the federal level, they're struggling to find tools to take care of privacy. But at the state levels, in a number of states, they already have some tools, and then they're reaching out for additional tools. So California, for example, has a constitutional, an inalienable right to a person's privacy. At the federal level, the Federal Trade Commission, who's in the business of enforcing laws or righting wrongs, has a Section 5 that gives them the ability to go out and look for really unfair or dishonest practices. And they use, you know, it used to be the internet, you would look at your user rules and your agreements for terms of use, and they would say, well, that's a contract. If you don't perform according to that contract, you know, that's a deceptive practice. Now they look and they say, well, you don't have terms of use. You don't have a privacy policy. You're dealing with information that somebody has a reasonable interest in, a reasonable expectation that they'll be free from observation or commerce. And you don't have a privacy policy, or you have one and you don't enforce it, or you have absolutely no or very little security in your service. Well, that's unfair. And there are some companies, Wyndham Hotels is pushing back and saying the FTC doesn't have the right or the authority to enforce the law in that respect. But Wyndham has been losing so far. And there are a number of wonderful, or not wonderful, very interesting settlement agreements and consent decrees that the FTC and the California Attorney General have gotten in this area. So I can talk for quite a long time about this area, but you know, the new standard is that you get in and you design for privacy from the beginning. And I know that's hard for an early stage company, but you really should, as you're moving towards your business model, take a couple of days, think about what data you are retrieving, how you're going to use it, if you have technology, what other information the sensor or whatever can pick up, and what you're going to do with that in terms of protection and use. And then you have to think about consents, and so on and so forth. But it's a very important drill, because as you move into the world of Cisco and SAP and the companies who might want to partner with you, might want to hire you, might want to acquire you, they're going to want those questions answered. And the old pattern of let's build something as quickly as we can, raise as much money as we can, and then go to the lawyers and ask for them to change our user agreements, it's just not the best way to do it.
And that, you know, just to amplify that, it's interesting. One of the things that when you buy one of these estimates that you use in software, if I turn that software on here, I can turn my phone into a device that has two unique numbers. And if you have some software on your phone, some of you may have it, you can see these numbers. If there was a way for these numbers to also carry data, to tell you about me, I would need to have the decision, do I share it or not? And if I don't have that decision and you take it, you're potentially in trouble. So I think consent, actually, opting into things, is really, really important in this new world. And gets around a lot of problems if you have opting in.
Can you tell the government that?
Yeah, we try. I have a little bit of a what mnemonic. I'm not sure, but you know, there are a number of fair information practice statements, and they can run from either 8 items through 3 items or 5 items. TLC SA, transparency, limits on the way you use it and what you collect, trying to minimize what you collect to the extent you can. Consent, very important. Security. And accountability. Keep your eye on the accountability.
So let's move on. Just so we don't take all the time with us answering, let's take 3 people all together and said, wants to go next. Gentleman at the back was the first hand I saw, then you, and then one over in that far corner over there. And then there'll be more. This is not the end.
Well, I'll try to speak up. You want to hear me?
So my name is Jeff Stevens, and you were asking for people that are deploying these technologies. And I work with companies deploying devices like this. This is a Bluetooth beacon, like the Eskimo you were showing. This is Qualcomm's little baby device right here. And there's two basic areas that we're using these low-energy Bluetooth beacons for. The low-hanging fruit is delivering information or coupons. So I'm working with a museum, for example, over in Europe. So instead of having to carry around those devices that you rent and have to go in the order of their tour, you can go up to any exhibit they have. And on your smartphone, there's not only something you can listen to about it, but there's also click-throughs for lots more information about the artist or the item. But more importantly, what we're working on is enriching experiences. So when you go to a venue, you have a better experience. And the leader in this domain recently announced that they're making $1 billion spend just on this one area, and that's Disney. So the key, you know, you were talking about privacy earlier, and you know, these are really just spitting out a number. It's just like our phones that we walk around with all the time that are broadcasting our MAC addresses. And a lot of people here don't know it, but you've been tracked for a long, long time now just based on your MAC address. So the tracking portion and what we can do in trying to understand what you're doing and predict what you might want to do next to add value and enrich your experience is what I work with my clients on most.
Right. I'm going to guess the Disney $1 billion is, you know, less than 10 million on hardware and the rest on all of the information services and software that they built on top of it, to Tony's point earlier. Is that right?
So actually, they're doing active RFID. And so a lot of their infrastructure is, their spend is in hardware. Right. So they're deploying very substantial infrastructure because there are a lot of limitations to low-energy Bluetooth. And active RFID, those are the magic bands that you all may have heard of. And the main thing that Disney's looking for is the same thing my clients are looking for. It's increased wallet share from their customer. By improving the experience, enriching the experience, they're hoping to get an increased wallet share. So imagine going up to a bar, and the bartender knows, you know, what's going on in your social sphere because you happen to have opted in by downloading and turning on an app from that venue. And so, and you log in with Facebook, so they're able to look at your social sphere. And so they know what's going on in your social sphere. And potentially they've got long-tail data on you on prior purchases. And so that bartender can now interact with you about things that you're interacting with your social sphere, and they know what types of drinks you like. So you have a better experience, you spend a little more money, the bartender gets a little nicer tip, and everybody wins.
Okay, let's come to the middle of the room here.
While you're moving down there, I want to mention one thing I thought. I mean, I'm a lawyer. I find some things hilarious that other people don't. But this morning in the Times, there was an article about General Mills' website. And essentially, they have embedded in one of their consents that if you download coupons from their website, you're forced into binding arbitration if you ever have to make a claim against General Mills. So you might think about putting that in.
Thank you.
Hi. I work for a company outside the U.S. Pretty big company. They are building a telehealth infrastructure, telehealth, similar to, somewhat adjacent to what Laura previously is doing. One of our most successful things is actually what we call a healthy city concept, where we enter a relationship with municipalities and provide the residents of that town or village or city telehealth service. And there's also a big data component of this, obviously, to do analytics, right? But my question is really, I'm interested in the home environment because we also have application given chronic disease management. And I would love to not worry about the connectivity of data, right? As we see ourselves as a software company and not as a hardware company. So I want to ask the panelists is that, do you see a consolidation in terms of the infrastructure at home that will support a sensor network? Because I can't build Wi-Fi to every sensor, right? And I don't want to buy a gateway from Qualcomm, a gateway from Intel, a gateway from Cisco, because, you know, where is the standardization and how can
it? Why isn't this the gateway? That's a good question. Mm-hmm. Several examples. So why isn't this in the hub?
It's not all the time. Not always. Phone is not a gateway.
No. It's not always on, and I turn my Bluetooth off because I want to conserve energy, battery power. I think half the people who has a smartphone probably turn their Bluetooth off.
I'm glad you missed all the smart people, because I would have had to think this was a gateway. That's not possible. I said I'm in this call, sorry to make you approach the
answer. No, it's okay.
Trying to be democratic in my distribution.
Hi, my name is Vatsusha. We have a startup based in San Diego. It's name is Ritmos Automation, and like we are on enterprise side of Internet of Things. So our platform loop normally connect these small devices, sensors. And once the data is like in the cloud or like wherever you want, it's an enterprise integration platform now. So we link this device data to complex event processing, CRM systems, or SAP Salesforce. Right now, we made connectors for SAP and Salesforce. So like we are normally backend as a service. So we connect these devices with enterprise in a seamless way. Because like these devices, gateway, they cannot like put, as you told, like they cannot integrate APIs for each and every software on their own. So we have designed one message-based architecture that links this end to this end. And I'd really like to get your feedback on it, because we are linking Cisco to SAP, something like that.
That would be the right thing to be doing in this room today. do you guys want to take some feedback now, or should we get some more?
I'd love to hear more.
Let's get some more. So we'll take three more. You know, one right in front there.
Hi, my name is Oliver Kim. I'm CEO and founder of Meta Group. We're the Munich computer vision technology creator, and just like Kit pointed out, everyone has this. We already have two sensors, GPS and camera sensor, imaging sensor, right? So why do we need to buy more sensors or hardware for creating IoT? With the technology that we can camera aim any object and then drop the digital content on top of it, is that you don't even have to be a content provider or a manufacturer. You can do it by yourself. So we're kind of creating Pinterest for real, or Web Genius for everything. So we're planning to open up the API so that anyone can create their own applications. So it could be a robotics application or a mobile phone or simple wearable devices. As long as you have the camera on it, then you can utilize our technology, and then you can define your own object, or you can ask the users to define their own object to submit to our server, and it will be handled by our side. And we already have our own application as a focusing on publication. We're growing a number of users and a number of objects collected from the user side. So hopefully, if you're interested, we definitely want to talk to you more about that. It's a free API.
Yeah, I think
Kit
was talking about the
Hi, my name is Brian Hughes. I'm co-founder and CTO of a company called GoFactory. We built a IoT platform, and we're currently working on a connected city project in the UK, so working with some major players. Our platform excels in quickly adopting and adding cloud connect sensors, Bluetooth LE sensors, even legacy UDP smart sensors like GPS units. But what's more important is that we kind of view the Internet of Things, the M2M, as missing the H, which is the human. And so when you start looking at connected city, it's much more important of how do the humans interoperate with the parking meters and the lights and the various components that actually create connected city. And that's what our platform is actually excels at, is bringing the human into the M2M.
Did you read Tom O'Reilly's?
Actually, I did, and I was like, oh, he's ripping us off.
So Tim O'Reilly yesterday's, I can't play the URL because it's not this long, but It's check him out on O'Reilly.com, and he wrote this thing called IOTH.
But that's our mantra, is that human is actually the factor in the Internet of Things. So it's pretty exciting for us. Like I said, we've actually found more traction throughout Europe. So we're actually talking to several companies in Paris and throughout the UK. And there's some real incentives there because, for example, the UK is going to run out of generating capacity around 2016. So they're looking for ways to optimize and make their cities more efficient. And so what happens with our platform is not only do we connect things together, bring people in, but we actually close the loop. We're able to change the behavior of the things as they're operating within the city or within the communities. And so we call that situational optimization. So situational awareness is the sensors, situational intelligence is the ability to take that in and do predictive analytics, and situational optimization is when you push action back out and change the behavior of the things. So.
If you ever wonder why there's so many bricks in the valley, it's what you just said, but you knew you were going to run out. So, for me as a layman, it can often sound buzzwordy, like connected city, for example. I'd love people to give use cases. Like, you gave a great use case, I completely got it immediately. Try and give a use case for what it is you do as well, so that those of us who are not thinking of that abstract level want to get ahead around it and understand exactly what you So, if someone decided that.
Hello, my name is Michael. I am kind of working on an encrypted email solution, and basically I've been working on this idea for a few years. I'm still in the kitchen table stage, looking for co-founders and support. The unique approach that I'm using with this is, I want to make encrypted email transparent, it's going to be built into the client. The added element there is I came up with an idea and methodology of tagging emails with information. Three basic categories. First level of tags or instruction is subject matter of the email. Second level, the sender can instruct how the email will be delivered, displayed, delete page, put it into a separate folder. The level is information about the email and or the sender. So, I was working on this for consumer interpersonal communication model. I was thinking, I'm trying to explore this hypothesis of possibly applying this to sensors or machine-to-machine exchange of data using email as alternative to FTP or direct connectivity. So once machines are like EMR, in healthcare, if you can trust the delivery and asynchronous communication, if you can trust that and it comes in with patient data, possibly the EMR can just trust that email that came in and extract the data out of there and put it into the EMR, the second EMR, to the receiver's EMR system. And I'm wondering, if that might be an alternative type of model. I think the benefit is that it's more of a distributed type of situation. For doctors, it could be, enable them to communicate with out-of-network doctors, who are not in a network or something like that. But more so, possibly, if this is could be like alternative type of data delivery, information delivery at like the sensor level or all these small machines.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So we've got about 20 minutes left before we do a wrap up, and I'm going to give these guys a little bit of time each at the end to talk about what they've heard and what they think. So let's try and keep it with you guys for now. Let's bring back questions as well. If you have a question you don't have something to talk about, but if you do have something you want to talk about that you're working on, that's okay too.
I have a question. It's relative to connectivity. The question is, large businesses typically provide problems in having a mesh network that's unreliable and with a vast quantity of sensors not saturating. What's out there? What is being provided? I haven't found anything that works with.
Any other questions? One of that.
Yes, I just want to understand the market space. Like teaching, for example, home appliance. So how they connect with the Internet of Things, and what's your opinion about the like a competitors in this space in the future of this space?
Hands up if you've got a Nest. You got Nest. I've got Nest. We just built a new house, so we've got. You know, I would have pretty much done anything, I can tell you that. But the only thing I found that I wanted to do was this. So I'm not sure how far along we are yet in the home, actually. I think there's still a lot to come. But with Nest, it's Wi-Fi. It uses your router as a, a kind of a transparent transport layer. It just needs a lot of your password and done. I don't know anything that uses Bluetooth in the house. I've got this thing on my Keurig that is from Elgato. It beeps. If I go too far away from my phone, it says you left your keys behind. Or alternatively, if I take this and leave my phone, it beeps and says I can't, you left your phone behind. And that's kind of marginally useful for me. And I've got another thing in my car, which is from a company called Automatic. And there's a great piece of software on here that tracks every single thing I do in the car, including if I brake too hard, if I accelerate too fast from a light, which I always do. So I'm kind of the buyer for all of this stuff. If it's there, I probably know about it. There isn't that much stuff yet. It isn't yet having a big enough impact on me for me to really just. And plus, I've got this thing which tells me how many steps I walked. But now I don't even need this because today, RunKeeper gave an app on an iPhone 5S that does even a better job than an iPhone wristband of doing that. So there are things happening, but it feels slower. I'm going to throw that back in a minute. Any more questions? One here?
Wanted to talk about a project?
Sure. Get a microphone. Here she comes.
So my name is Joe Blau, and I'm the co-founder of a company called Teamopsis. And what we're trying to do is abstract away a lot of the individual Internet of Things that people are going to interact with daily. And we want to build a mobile application that will allow you to seamlessly integrate with all of the devices in your life. So for example, in the average person's wake-up experience, you get up, you check the weather, you know, you might turn on some lights, you might start up some coffee. And what we do is we're building an application that uses machine learning as well as some user input to create a way for your experience in the morning to be seamless. So, for example, in my house, I have a prototype running where I wake up, and as soon as I wake up, my iPhone checks the weather, and then it tells me and it reads to me the weather using the Siri voice. And then I also have smart lights, so my smart lights fade in. And then when I get to my bathroom, I have Eskimo beacons in my bathroom, so the bathroom lights turn on using Philips Hue smart lights. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to automate the tasks in life that you do all the time. So for example, if you have a Tesla, that's not very popular outside of the Valley, but there are a lot of them in the Valley. And so if you walk up to your car, the car is smart enough where you can configure the seating arrangements and everything before you even get to the car. So where we see this going is that we want to create what's called a contextual graph. So Google owns the knowledge graph, which is everything you know. Facebook owns the social graph, which is everybody you know. And we're trying to control this contextual graph, which is you and all the smart things that you're interfaced with. That way we can enhance your experiences down the line. So for example, when you check into a hotel, it knows that your settings at home are a certain way for the lights, and it will configure those for you. Or if you rented a car in the future and it's a smart car, it would know that the car, it knows your height and your driving position and what radio you like to listen to, and it will automatically configure that for you. So that's kind of something.
And is that an app level thing? Is it a cloud service? What is it?
It ties in with a few of the things that you were saying. So some of those, this man right here mentioned that your phone's not always on. So for some of the things, we have a back-end system that's actually doing asynchronous processing. And then for a lot of the things, they're based on context, right? So you need your phone. Your phone knows where you are. Your phone has 12 sensors on it that are tracking stuff all the time. So it combines both of those together.
Is that a Crunch-based t-shirt you're wearing?
This is a Firebase
t-shirt. Oh. It would not surprise you if it's 20 of my friends.
So we're using Firebase because we have a virtualized world that we're testing this stuff in, and so we're using Firebase to communicate back and forth to kind of show virtual lights and virtual colors.
Okay, gentleman in the middle here.
I have a question for Tom, or ask you to comment on it. And you could probably go on for hours on this, but think of the most important things you want to say. I think probably everybody here who's developing in this world realizes we're in sort of the API-ification of software development. And especially in the Internet of Things world, we're going to have more and more products and services that incorporate lots of other third-party software, services, backends, and things like that. I was wondering if you could comment a little bit on some of the implications with respect to liability, data ownership, and you know some of the things that people like us need to be aware of as they establish these relationships, contract for services, indemnification and liability chains that get created that we never really had to worry about before when you just made your own thing.
No, that's a terrific issue that a number of our clients come face-to-face with every day. And that's, you know, what you do is you map out who your relationships are with, and you look at the inputs. You know, if you're an analytics company and you're pulling in data from somebody else, consider where did that data come from, what kind of ownership do you want to have of what you do to that data, what kind of a promise or representation do you want from them that they got it the right way. And then further indemnification, are they willing to step up and indemnify you if it turns out that they've stolen it from somebody else, or there's a problem with the way they got it, there's a flawed consent someplace, or they're otherwise a bad actor. So on your inputs, you want to just use common sense, commercial, with a legal accent analysis on those things. Map them out and figure out what your exposures could be and cover them. On the way out, similar drill. What am I supposed to be delivering? If I'm doing analytics, how clearly worded is the IP provision for my customer? Because, of course, the customer will want to use the result of your analytics. Maybe they'll want to publish it someplace. Well, are you giving them a license? Are you giving them ownership? If you give them ownership, then you have a problem using it. Similarly with indemnification, what kind of risk do you want? It's very common in medical device companies, for example, I can recall latex was a hot button 10, 15 years ago. Well, latex producers wouldn't sell latex to medical device manufacturers unless they got an indemnity back from the manufacturer that says, whatever you do with our product, unless there's something inherently wrong with the product, because we didn't manufacture it the right way, you're indemnifying us for claims, because when the class action comes, we'll be named. And so you have to take the same approach. Now, there's a lot of David and Goliath stuff out there, and there's also a lot of lack of sophistication sometimes in the companies you might deal with. They may be dealing with, they just had something, a bank taking an IT product, and the agreements looked like they were ordering paperclips. And so you have to really go through them and make sure that the uses are covered, and at the end of the day you have the rights that you think you should have, and the protections that you think you should have, and you're not overextending yourself unwittingly on providing protections or rights to somebody else. If you've done it a few times, it's pretty straightforward.
One last question, then we're going to come back to the panel. Yeah.
I don't need a mic.
I can tell that.
You don't really loud anyway. I'm actually not a developer, I'm not a startup. My clients are the big Fortune 500 companies in retail. And the problem I'm having is that I'm the CEO of Whisper. And the CIO, the tech solutions, are actually more of the tactical solutions, only because I think, in a way, all the great ideas here, they may be passable in a fast-moving consumer goods category, but in the luxury retail world, there's just a huge gap. And for me, I'm really curious, what do you think on a macro scale is going to take? Is it time, or I'd like to hear actually more specifics, but what is it going to take to get it to a level where, you know, it can be much more intuitive, it can be much more of an elegant solution that I can, you know, that's not clunky and no risk.
So I'm imagining things like, and then retail is the one area I've been a little bit thinking about. I'm imagining things like, you know, I walk into Fry's, which my wife Leslie and I would do whenever I can. And as I walk through the door, you know, passbook on my phone gets the 10 coupons that I might want to spend whilst I'm in there. And I don't have to do anything other than walk in. If I've consented, they can know it's me. So that can be a really good choice of 10 coupons. If I haven't consented, I'd probably just get any old 10 coupons and they. But there's a dialogue between the retailer and me, preferably informed by who I am. If I'm a bit skiddy about that and I don't want to share anything with them, and not informed by who I am, but probably not as good cost. That to me is where retail is going. ShopKick kind of tried to get a little bit there by putting audio, that we can't hear, that your phone can hear, so the phone would know which floor you're on or which county you're standing at in the store. With these things, the Apple Store already has it, so if you're running the Apple Store app, as you walk around the store, shelf by shelf, your phone will reflect what's in front of you. But it doesn't know who you are unless you're running the Apple Store app, and you can't see it unless you're running the Apple Store app. So there's some constraints there to the point, there's some limits. If you are running the Apple Store app, of course they've got your credit card, so you can scan the QR code and walk out with the product and then talk to the shop assistant, which is awesome. I've done it a couple of times. Feels a little bit like a stealer. You kind of look around and wonder when someone's going to stop you. But you know, you can start to see in retail little bits of what it should be, but mostly it's not there.
I want to up the ante. I think Dinesh had said, give me more specifics. So I'm talking about like the
Neiman Marcus
stuff, right?
I can talk about
Burberry,
and I can all the things.
So let's do that. Yeah. You're the first one. We'll go in order, and let's use this as our wrap-up.
So I'm going to address your case. We are implement now with one of the largest shopping chains that you see in Virgin Europe. As you drive up, your phone, you're part of their loyalty program. You've got an implicit understanding about wanting to be a loyal customer. You have some benefit. All of this is a quid pro quo. You know, as long as you're getting benefit from something, people are willing to give information. As an anecdote, you know, one of the largest pharmaceutical companies on the planet suddenly started to give results of clinical trial data back to the people that they were testing the drugs on. It was mind-boggling to me that for 50 years, this didn't happen. And suddenly the level of additional incremental feedback that started to come back, which made the trial even more valuable, was amazing. And what's important about that is because payers, the insurance companies who actually pay for drugs, do not like paying for drugs when they first come to market because they believe in the inherently flawed clinical trials. And they wait for 2 years, highly profitable 2 years, highly profitable patent 2 years, expiring 2 years. And so these are things that I think we're going to see as far as privacy and people wanting to volunteer information. That's going to change over the next 10, 15 years. I've heard different things from different companies which talk about in 5-10 years' time, you're going to probably generate $1,200 incremental revenue to each person based on selling certain aspects of personal information. Today, it's nearly always you can't have anything or you can have everything. And so we're going to get nuanced. You're going to be really busy in the next 10 years' time. And so, you know, the whole notion around some of the ideas that I saw said to the audience kept coming back to this theme of automate. I think it was the guy with the contextual graph. That's the common thing for enterprise, the common thing that is for your daily life. But what is that level of automation? That level of automation is getting into a car and telling me I need to go to this address. Well, in fact, I get into the car and the car is seamlessly connected, so it just knows the address to go to. You know, it's not going to finish. Nest is another example. I have a Nest, and it's great, but at the end of the day, I never want to send another thermostat in my life ever again. it's going to take time to get there. And there's nothing you can do to get past that passage of time. So the work that we did with Burberry is presenting that highly seamless experience that we have in terms of the high-end clientele. It takes true innovative leaders who now also have to have left Burberry and now are running things at Apple, which is what Angela is doing, to do those kinds of things. It's just going to take a passage of time. It's going to allow people to see successful use cases. That's why Tony and I have talked very intently about industries which are, I categorize them as halfway across the bridge. They already understand the value of monitoring things and what it can bring. And they're just looking and saying, well, if we increase the number of sensors at 10x, the granularity of data that we can bring gives us something else. That's why things are going to move differently. Retail is a topic that's near and dear to my heart, as Tony knows. And you know, we've done a lot of work in that. But there is also a thin line between creepy and valuable, right? I'm not prone to click on online ads. But if it's something that's given to me when I'm within 5 feet, it's something I'd get a 90% click through, most likely. That contextual aspect of it is something I would advise everybody in this room to concentrate on.
The ones I had, when you just bought something, and they keep giving you ads, and I think you just bought them.
<That's right.
laughs> So, you know, think of it this way, just going back, not to your specific question, but, I mean, if you think of the IoT, the key verticals that you will go and touch, you need to be very careful about, there's about four categories, right? You need to really understand that market, you need to understand the person that you're selling to or you're delivering the value to, and I think the most important thing is the business market, because quite often you could have the best solution in the world, but you know, it's locked up through a certain set of channels that if you don't have access to it, you will not be successful. And you know, we've spent a lot of time at Cisco trying to understand that. So one of the areas that is big, I think it's halfway across the bridge, we're spending a lot of time on at Cisco, is the industrial space, right? It's massive, it's big, but it's slow moving, conservative, risk averse, taking decades to make decisions and stuff, but when they do, it's big and the margins are very good. So that's what one big area. The other area that's kind of very big is consumer. So we talk about homes, gateways. You know, before I joined Cisco, I had my own company in home automation and home control. It was a Danish company. We were way ahead of our time. We were building these really low power chipsets, you know, under a buck that we could connect anything inside the home. And then we realized it's not about connectivity because there's not one company that builds everything inside your home. There's one that builds a thermostat, another guy has the light bulbs, another guy has the light switches, there's another guy that has this and that. And then none of them want to work with each other. So then we built a protocol called Z-Wave and became a very successful standard. That's where I sold the company to make sure that, you know, I don't need to know anything from those guys. I will make it interoperable. I will self-discover that this thing is a light bulb, this thing is this and that, and make them talk to each other. So we try to take all that stuff away, and it was all about interoperability, but we're still way ahead of our time. Right? So right now the service providers are very interested in the consumer space, you know, the Comcast, you know, AT&T's, and they're trying to go there, but it's going to be a very, you know, high volume of cutthroat type of business, and then there's yet another layer below that, which is when you get into the wearables, and it's going to be a massive market, and it's one of those things that, you know, I've been in that space. Before you introduce this product, you get ready to sell it, you're planning the end of life, there's the next one coming out. So you're on a treadmill of every 3 to 6 months, and you're going to throw 30 things at, you know, Best Buys, and two is going to sit, right? So you're just going to, like, massively run through this thing, right? And then, so anyway, there's that consumer space that's kind of big, and then there's the public sector, which is where you're working with government, cities, you know, we've done 150 smart cities, all the parking, lighting, and then you're dealing with mayors, each one of them have a 4-year election cycle, they do things when they're in,
and they don't do anything until the one gets reelected again. You got to catch it at the right moment, and it's big governmental relationships, all that kind of stuff. So you got to be very careful to understand your market. Who are you going after? What are you trying to do? You know, going back to retail, we have a big practice around fast retail, right? So retail is an interesting one because it crosses the two worlds. The luxury guys, I mean, we spend a lot of time with Burberry, Gucci, and all those guys. It's all about experience. It's the experience that you're going to provide someone that you walk into the store. So at the very low end of it, we have worked with Starbucks, and their biggest thing right now is how many people abandon the line because they just get tired, they don't want to wait, or whatever, or McDonald's. So what can technology do to convert those, and that's worth a lot of money. To the other extreme where, you know, if you go into Neiman Marcus, you know, you want to be greeted by your name, your profile, everything about you, the type of stuff that you will like. So it's some level of analytics that you have to apply that this person is going to like these kind of stuff and present them with that. And what if there was something that that person may have liked, but they never got to see it and they lost the sale? And these are high-value sales. And then how do you follow up? So, you know, the whole experience, you know, whether it's a consumer level, whether it's a train station, just letting people that, hey, you know, the train is coming in 12 minutes. If they know it, they're okay. But if they don't know it, they get pissed off, right? So it's just like those kind of stuff that you really need to go deep into every industry, understand at the core of it, who's the audience, what is the value that you're trying to deliver, and then the most important thing is route to the market. To even create the best stuff. But you see, like in this oil and gas, it's dominated by Honeywell, Emerson, Yokogawa. And if you don't partner with them, you don't, you're not going to go to market. So these are all the kind of stuff that you really need to try to figure out.
Yeah, and to continue that thought, we represent a lot of high-end retail. We represent a lot of energy companies as well. And the high-end clients and customers don't buy junk. They want to buy something that is going to work right from the jump. It's going to be, the creepy factor is reduced. You know, in high-end retail, you have to be careful if you've got multiple customers that you're not sharing the shopper information from one person shopping at Burberry, you know, with a competitor, so that shapes, you know we now know their preferences because we have Burberry data or somebody else's data. So you do have to be a little careful there. From the lawyer's point of view, you also need then to pay attention to your privacy policies in terms of use. A lot of studies have happened recently that show that in the Internet of Things, people have just taken website privacy policies in terms of use. There are very few products out there that have well thought out, customized terms of use and privacy policies. Nest is actually one of them. So I think that's an important drill. The other part is that if you have a device that is going to be networked or talk to other devices, and a lot of the devices and sensors out there live to communicate. And I don't mind really what my Nest knows about me, but if my refrigerator has a big mouth, I'm going to be concerned about where that data goes. And a lot of these, the Nest was really, as I think they said to Honeywell, was invented from the ground up. A lot of the other intelligent appliances have add-ons, and they may not be as well thought out. Obviously, the better the company, the more reliable you hope it will be, but be careful of the neighbors in your service or in your product, who they may be talking to, and how easily the security of those, the network and your device can be compromised by somebody else.
So I think that's pretty much it. I just sum up by saying it feels to me as if, I'm not a young guy and I've lived through some revolutions in technology all the way back to networking, like this handout, twisted pair initially, through to the LAN moving to the WAN, the internet, social networks and MySQL, mobile. It feels to me as if each one of these revolutions created massive, massive businesses. And we're at the very, very beginning of the transformation where the real world gets kind of lit up and available to be discovered using these in the cloud. And that's going to create just huge new businesses. Some of them will be new businesses, some will be existing businesses that figure out how to grow really rapidly, certainly opportunities. But all of us will do very well by focusing on it. I think that's probably why we're all here today. I've enjoyed it. I've learned a lot. Thank you to our panelists, all three of them, and to you guys. Thank you. So lastly, thank you to Sharma and Meetup for providing us with these great facilities. Thank you.
Staying a little bit longer, because we do have another short time from Cisco DIR. I was talking about this incubation program. I think you all stand up, you're interesting, and I would like to first, I really appreciate our speakers. It was such a wonderful discussion today, and it's a test of economic exchange, and then. The next, I would like to help you guys a little bit because the moment you move, those people move. So please stay here. And then, so I would like to introduce my manager, Tom Tariyaka. Tom Yoritaka is the director of Cisco Entrepreneurs in Residence and Cisco Support Community. So he will introduce our incubation program, and also there are a couple of startup companies going to talk about their experience with the EIR program.
Right. So for those of you who are startups, you absolutely need to stay now, because this can be interesting.
Well, thank you. But I'm not sure I was coming up with jokes to keep irritating, sorry, to keep everyone stay here. So my name is Javier Chaka. I'm a senior director at Cisco, and I'm also the managing director of our incubation program, startup innovation program called Cisco Entrepreneur for Residence. And I know we don't have a lot of time, but let me ask, what word comes to mind when you hear the word accelerator or corporate innovation or incubation program? What comes to mind?
Advisors.
Startups?
Advisors.
Money, lots of money, okay. Resources, yeah. Cisco Entrepreneurs in Residence, Cisco EIR, is a little bit of an accelerator and a little bit of an incubation program, corporate incubation program, in the sense that it brings the openness of an accelerator to early stage startups in the B2B space, but it also gives you access to Cisco and resources from Cisco. And so it brings the best of both worlds together with a strong Cisco flavor to support the startups. We just launched our first cohort, and some of the companies are here today, and I'll make an introduction for each of them. It's a six-month in-residence program for early-stage startups, mostly a pre-series A, seed-funded or even self-funded. And we have, we talk to companies that are sort of using their family savings and credit cards to start their companies. And the benefits are funding. I think you all have correct answers. Funding from Cisco. Basic infrastructure like co-working space provided by Cisco free of charge. Access to Amazon Web Services, again, free of charge. And most importantly, access, as I said, to Cisco. And this is an opportunity for startups coming into a program to have the rare access to Cisco engineering, Cisco product management teams, and Cisco go-to-market teams. They really evaluate the technology and look for ways to partner potentially to go to market. It's 6 months long, we have first cohort here. We're accepting applications for our summer 2014. That's going to be a second cohort, and we have a huge focus on IoT/IoE. Our doors are open to all B2B startups, but our primary focus is early stage startups in IoT and IoE. So this, I'm guessing, it's you're all entrepreneurs in the IoT space, so it's a perfect audience. And we apologize; we found out about this event at the very last minute, so we're kind of inserting ourselves almost off agenda here. But we'd love for you to check out the program and talk to me, talk to my team afterwards. And before you go,
when does the summer program begin?
We're shooting for late July to early August, and the pipeline is open right now, and it's open to exactly entrepreneurs like you.
Now, application form.
Yeah, so we have a website. Mm-hmm. We have a website, so we'll share that information afterwards for sure.
One other question: does Cisco
like some incubators and accelerators get equity in the companies. Do you do that, or do you, or is this more of a biz dev thing?
Well, it's we have several options from a funding perspective. So we give X dollars to each company, and we're open to having that equity relationship, or we can do a convertible note, or we can do something else. So we have several options depending on what you like to do.
Not a gift. It's not a gift.
No, it's not a gift.
it's important to clarify this.
Yes, so it's not a cash grant program, but it's a very generous, I think, from our vantage point, it's a very generous funding relationship. But most importantly, it's really access to our engineering teams and go-to-market teams. And we have information on our website, or you can come talk to me after the event today. And let me, if I go too far here, let me introduce our cohort here. We've got five companies in our cohort today. Four of them here. We just finished a lunch at Cisco. We just came over. So let me first introduce DG Logic. Okay. So we have five companies in the cohort. All of them touch IoT and IoE one way or another. This company is squarely in IoT, and they're building technology to manage machine data and visualize in a way that's consumable. So let's do a 30-second spiel from DG Logic.
Thanks, Tom.
Yep.
Hi, my name is Dinesh, and I'm the Chief Technology Officer of DG Logic. And our slogan is, we are enabling and visualizing the Internet of Things. We've already been in the market, and we've enjoyed success in the macro IoT world, which means we've been automating buildings, cities, islands. I'll actually show an example of Richard Branson's private island that we're working on. And what we have a couple products in the market. One of them is DigiBox, which is again for macro IoT play, and the other one is DigiLux, which is for visualizing all of this information that is coming from all of these sensors and discrete devices. The one thing that I'd like to do real quick is to show some examples of interfaces that have been developed over the past few years for different types of applications using our technology. And our technology is 100% HTML5 web-based technology for building interactive visualizations for dealing with real-time sensor data that can come in from every few milliseconds to analytical historical data. Next thing I'd like to do is to show a very quick example of really the theme of what we're doing, because what we're trying to do is to connect all of these devices, and a lot of things were said about different devices, different manufacturers, none of them are working together. So we have a toolkit that we've created, and we're working on open sourcing it for new device manufacturers, so that if you want to create a new IoT device, you just use our technology and you get the best of both worlds. Security, integration, management on enterprise level provisioning, policy management, as well as visualization, which is really key for user interfaces. Real quick, I'll log into our application. Okay.
He's overachieved by 400%.
Right. Well, doesn't win in. But if you have any more questions, and again, I'll get off the stage. But if you have any more questions, please talk to us right after, and we'll be able to go into detail about our technologies, about how we're connecting devices, visualizing devices, and making pretty much everybody's startup life much easier. But you know, I can't think it's great.
For the second company, Secure Waters, another IoT company in our cohort. We'll make this quick, I promise. It's a different flavor. IoT is such a huge space, and that's what I think gets everyone excited, because it's such, brings such an opportunity for us. And it's an IoT company. It's a very different company. It looks nothing like the company just heard from. James from Secure Waters, the company hails from Tennessee. And let's do a 30-second spiel.
Absolutely. Good afternoon, everyone, to the panel and all the attendees. My name is James Wilson. I'm from a company called Secure Waters. We have a unique instrument that will very much open and advent the beginning, we believe, of the water security industry right now. All you can do in water security is either take images or video, or have a man or a technician come up and take a sample and take it to a gas chromatograph or a chromatograph. $50,000 instruments, the sample sitting in a queue, it's a big latency on delay about what's in the water. Ours are autonomous, cheap, deployable in a sensor net or IoT environment. We're very excited. We're just now getting traction with our production, and we've come out here to the Valley and had a wonderful time so far with our partners at Cisco, and encourage all the startups that are still out here to very definitely look at the program and apply for it. It's benefited us greatly. I hope that you've found interest in my 30-second spiel, and welcome any questions that you might have.
Just one question.
Yes, sir.
So does it mean that you are monitoring the quality of the water? Is that what you do?
If you want to, by the way of detection of toxins in the water, call it quality, then yes, sir. So absolutely, yes.
But you're not telling me I can drink it.
That depends on the individual.
depends on his stomach.
It depends on how your constitution is like. We look at, right now we have 700 toxins, everything from BX, or atrazine, diuron, agricultural, intentionally deployed, accidentally deployed, like in Charleston, West Virginia recently, coal ash chemicals that have happened in the Clinch River and the Dan River, our instrument detects. So we are, we're very excited, it's unique, it's and IoT, we're very glad to be here.
Yeah, I think it's perfect because we're not looking at IoT as a monolithic opportunity, we're looking at these targeted verticals, and one of them is water management. And, here in California, we're constantly facing water problems, water shortage, so it's a very local problem, and it's a global problem. You know, water is one of the most scarce precious resources, and it's often a source of conflict. So, I think we're excited to have this company on board, and I think it brings all of us a tremendous opportunity.
Okay, thank you.
So that was company number two. Prakash, we have a company started in Bangalore. Now it's bringing its presence over here to Silicon Valley. Prakash from Power.
Thank you so much. I'm Prakash Glasgow from Power Software. We provide file security. Nothing new in that space except that, in the recent days, WikiLeaks and Snowden has proved that, we don't have the best security out there. So what we do is that we don't have our own encryption algorithm. Encryption is great. We found that the problem is with the key management, the identity management. And we remove those bottlenecks. And we have a platform and a container-based technology. We take any file, encrypted with three random keys. We use standard AES-256. And with that, we provide the ability to secure file exchanges between any two parties under any type of transaction, be it email, be it cloud storage, be it bring your own devices. And more importantly, like Tom said, when your IoTs and IoEs are going to be exchanging so much information, you can be registering all of them in a centralized location, generating keys for them, and use them for encryption. It has to be transparent. You need to be able to control the access, and you need to be able to secure them, allow access for information only for the authorized devices and clouds and users, and deny access everywhere else. That's exactly what we bring into the picture. We containerize the data and make sure that only the authorized devices or authorized users or clouds can consume it and deny access for everybody else. And we offer it as data security as a service or encryption as a service, import it as a platform so anybody can use the APIs to integrate for securing the data and controlling the access. I'm around. If you guys have more questions, we'll be happy to answer. Thank you.
This is our last company. Petascure, another security company, but again, it's a security is a broad space. So this is this company is going after a very different part of the security space.
Thank you, Tom. Good afternoon. I'm a representative of Techcrunch.
We are doing enterprise security intelligence, and we are re-architecting and re-imagining the whole SIEM plus the security analytics space. And with IoT and everything being connected, it is a very big challenge for the security operation center. And with every kind of challenge comes the opportunity, and that's where we are. So we are
I think it's great. I think it's this opportunity around IoT, it really multiplies the security space. You know, the more data you have, you're collecting more data from more machines, from more places. And the need for analytics solutions like the one that Smith just talked about from PetaSecure, we see a huge opportunity there. So we see security as almost an adjacent, interconnected opportunity next to IoT. And so we're very excited to have this company in our cohort. It kind of ties back into a theme of IoT and IoE, and I think we're going to have a terrific time partying together.
Okay.
Thank you. So I know this was kind of a last minute insertion into the program. We don't have time for questions, right? So.
Well, we have some questions, maybe three.
Okay, three questions. Anything about the program? Fred.
Are you guys focusing primarily on B2B? I heard you mention.
Yes, we are. Yeah. Okay.
But Tommy will be here. Are you
here? No questions, then.
Can talk to you like one-on-one.
So Cisco Entrepreneurs and Raises, you can look it up on the web. And I will follow up with, I guess, Qiming has your contact information. So we'll send you some information afterwards and you can talk to us again.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And then let's give one more applause to our panel. Okay.